Team, thanks for having me in this outstanding symposium. I hope to fulfill your expectations. And ladies and gentlemen, I think many of you will have started fantasizing about big German lunches. So the short answer to the question if univentricular hearts are a paradigm for lifelong heart failure, yes, probably. Having said that, I'll discuss some of the data that is around and share some of my thoughts and ideas with you on this challenging subject. As you all know, there's no such thing as a univentricular heart, and actually this is a mixed bag of diagnosis with very rare lesions ranging from tricuspid atresia to double inlet left ventricle and many others. François Fontan in the 1970s considered that if pulmonary vascular resistance is low, then systemic venous return can go directly into the pulmonary artery. And thanks to this brilliant concept, we now have a way of treating these patients in a palliative way. The original concept of connecting the atria directly to the pulmonary artery was abolished, and now we have what we call the toto-caval pulmonary connection, which can be done with two techniques. If you connect the systemic venous return directly to the pulmonary artery, then what you get is systemic post-capillary energy contributing to the pulmonary circulation, and in that way, intrinsically, cardiac output will be limited, since this is driven, since pulmonary circulation is driven by this systemic return, and there's no ventricle that supports the pulmonary circulation. So clearly this has some disadvantages, and we see important adaptations in physiology after the Fontan operation. There's an increased systemic arterial resistance, there is redistribution of cardiac output to vital organs, there's an increased oxygen content, and the net effect is to maintain adequate oxygen transport to the tissues. So is this a paradigm for failure? Well, let's look at some data. This is a compilation of survival curves taken from many studies that have been around, and you can note at least that there is a significant increase in direct postoperative survival. So we have achieved a lot in the past decades. If you look at the angle of these survival curves, then you may get the impression that there is a less attrition during long-term follow-up in patients that have been operated more recently. But, of course, there is a difference in follow-up duration. We generally recognize that these patients are at risk for important morbidity, heart failure, arrhythmias, and Fontan-associated sequelae like protein-losing enteropathy, thromboembolism, and we have come to recognize Fontan-associated liver disease in recent years. You may ask yourself, how often does Fontan failure occur? Well, you see different percentages throughout literature, and this is in part because the definition of Fontan failure varies, and people groups have reported different results using different definitions. But generally, excessive limitations of the Fontan physiology, abnormal hemodynamics, poor functional status, Fontan sequelae, and non-cardiac and organ impairments may be part of the definition. This is data taken from a recent publication on Fontan failure from the Texas Children's Group in Houston. And this is a very large hospital, and even they have only 48 patients at 15-year follow-up. So this is an important aspect to recognize, I would say. Looking at their 15-year follow-up survival, it's about 10 to 15% of these patients that have gone into Fontan failure. It would be very helpful to have a sort of classification that can guide us in deciding which therapy to use in these patients. And there have been attempts to actually classify Fontan failure, but since there is much overlap within individual patients between these different phenotypes, this is not something that has come to widespread use. If we want to learn on the outlook of Fontan patients, there is a wealth of data around. Much of this data is retrospective by nature, And there's also a huge heterogeneity in the makeup of these study populations. And this makes comparison somewhat difficult. I think it's very important that there is a group, and it's a group in Osaka in Japan, that has published not only serial follow-up, but also serial follow-up with hemodynamic measurements. And I think they're one of the very few groups that have published on that. And therefore, I will cite much from their work. This is what we all know. Patients, as they get older, will decrease in New York Heart Association functional class, and they will their exercise performance will also decrease. The exercise performance, if there is a more than 3 points per year decline in a predicted oxygen uptake, this has been demonstrated by the group in Mayo Clinic, that this predicts the subsequent risk for cardiac events. And temporal changes in oxygen uptake during exercise testing related to changes in stroke volume and cardiac index, which is not totally a surprise. This again is hemodynamic serial follow-up by the group in Osaka, and it demonstrates that there is a decrease in cardiac index, there's an increase in systemic vascular resistance, and perhaps it is not appreciated by everyone that pulmonary vascular resistance in this group does not have a tendency to increase. Actually, it decreased in their patients. What is a problem in these patients is that central venous pressure may be enlarged. There may be an increase in end-diastolic pressure, and this relates to the amount of AV valve regurgitation. So if we consider that central venous pressure relates to outcome in these patients, the next question is, okay, what are the potential sources of increase of central venous pressure? And if we go from systemic venous entry into the arterial output, then there may be a problem in the Bethel stenosis, there may be a problem in pulmonary vascular resistance, there may be a problem with anatomical stenosis of pulmonary artery or pulmonary veins. We don't know much about atrial function, but it can be a problem. And AV valve regurgitation and diastolic dysfunction obviously may cause problems like increased central venous pressure. With regard to the Bethel, we all know that there is maybe anatomical stenosis in the Bethel itself or in the vessels connecting to it. And the group in Philadelphia, Mark Vogel, as a pediatric cardiologist and engineers from computational fluid dynamics, have very elegantly demonstrated that there is power loss in the Fontaine pathway, which may have consequences for how this is built during surgery. And this relates to not only to the anatomy, but also to of the Bethel itself, but also to the large vessels connected to it. And there is power loss with exercise. And this has been demonstrated in computational fluid dynamic models and later on also in real-life patients. Another source of problems in the Fontan circulation may be the pulmonary artery, clearly. And there's not much data around on the growth of the pulmonary artery in these patient groups, unless for some older studies using CATH data. When we used MR and looked at the 5-year follow-up, we noted that there is an adequate growth appropriate to body size in these patients. Of course, there is a highly abnormal flow pattern in these pulmonary arteries, and pulsatility and distensibility are highly abnormal, but we did not see any serial changes. Yet these abnormal pulsatility and distensibility may be a problem on the very long run, since this may influence endothelial function. There's not much information around with regard to atrial function, which is remarkable considering the highly abnormal atrial part of the cardiac cycle in these patients. This is data from a combined multi-center Dutch cohort and data from Boston Children's Hospital. And in the first publication we did on this topic, we looked at the differences between ILT atrial function and APC, so the old abolished type of Fontan operation, and we noted that there was a difference in synergy between the pulmonary venous flow, pulmonary venous contraction pattern, and the Fontan Bethel with regard to timing of these phenomena. And this may be one of the reasons why patients with a APC don't do as well as the other combinations of the other modifications of surgery. The size of the ventricle, and this has been well known has been described by various groups, matters in Fontan patients. And many groups have looked at ejection fraction, and the Japanese group, as well as some others, did not find a long-term important change in this factor. And this may relate to the fact that we generally tend to test the engine just at rest. And what we did, we started a few years ago with testing the Fontan patients if they had an indication for MR, and using a type of stress to test their functional reserve. And we have now have follow-up data up till 10 years. So patients had an initial baseline MR up to 10 years ago, and we determined functional reserve. And in a relatively young group of patients, we noted that an adequate functional reserve related to a composite endpoint that indicated their long-term outcome. And we also tested other well-known risk factors, and none of them came out in this young group, so we think this might be a powerful marker. So what most of you going to meetings like this tend to want to hear is, okay, what factors can I use in clinical practice? So I tried to compile some of the well-known risk factors for increased mortality. And we discussed central venous pressure, we discussed oxygen saturations, arrhythmias, clearly is not a good sign, thromboembolic events, lower single ventricular global longitudinal strain, it has been discussed this morning, is an important factor, as is the size of the right ventricle, and we think functional reserve also contributes to this. Other factors are from exercise testing. It's clearly not good if you cannot increase heart rate or if you have very poor oxygen uptake, and this is predictive of severe mortality, morbidity and mortality over the long run. Then, of course, if a patient develops PLE or cirrhosis, this is something we try to want to avoid. And another thing that's not good for patients with a Fontan cyclism is living at high altitude, and there are other markers. Considering the heterogeneity of studies that have been around, it has been very difficult to come up with what we probably all would like to have a Fontan failure score. Time is not yet there to have that. One of the questions in this symposium is, okay, if we have a tendency to fail, how can we get out? Well, in a Fontan patient, you need to consider treating obstructions in the Fontan pathway, close shunts, reduce pulmonary vascular resistance, although, and with regard to the Japanese data, perhaps that's not really surprising, but studies looking at the short to mid-term effects of drugs to reduce pulmonary vascular resistance have not been very successful in these patients so far. We have no clue on how to improve atrial function, but potentially this is important. We need drugs that improve diastolic function. Unfortunately, there seem to be some drugs in the pipeline that we may want to use in these patients particularly. And then, and I did not discuss this because of time, but there's a very important role for considering ventricular arterial coupling in these patients. Consider the extensive reconstructions that many of these patients have to undergo to have the Fontan circulation reconstructions in the aorta. This must have an impact on ventricular arterial coupling, and we may miss some of the points here if we don't acquire additional data that will help us in this aspect. A challenging subject is how can we provide energy to the subpulmonary circulation, and there have been various devices that have been designed for this purpose. They actually work, but the problem, of course, is how to prevent thromboembolic problems and how to supply these devices with energy. But this is a promising field of research. Perhaps another promising field is to use the muscle pump to support the venous return. And I'd like to point out some remarkable regional differences if you go to literature with regard to what is normal for exercise performance. This is data of a relatively young group of Dutch children who have an exercise performance with a Fontan circulation about 74% of predicted at the age of 12. And if you look at the Japanese data, patients at the same age have a 10% point lower maximal oxygen uptake. So it's tempting to think that this may relate to how your lifestyle stimulates you to use the muscle pump. And this is a typical Dutch scene, cycling to school. Children do this every day, and adults luckily start or continue this lifestyle. And I'm very happy to see that the Berliners have taken the message very well. So to summarize, the Fontan circulation is an intrinsically abnormal hemodynamic state in which sequelae are not unexpected and in fact common. We don't know exactly how often Fontan failure occurs, and of course this relates to the age of the patient and the duration of follow-up. We might want to learn lessons from what an excellent Fontan patient is, and this is a patient with low central venous pressure, normal oxygen saturation, normal AV valve function, low end diastolic pressure, normal functional reserve, etc. And it's very challenging and exciting to see how patients fulfilling these criteria will develop on the long run. And perhaps these are not the patients that are doomed to fail. But definitely we need additional therapy, lusitropic drugs, assist devices for the pulmonary circulation, power training, and others, other ideas that we can conceive of. Thank you very much.